So yesterday we started with a new topic which was called as asymmetric key cryptography, right? So let's proceed further. So we'll just revise in 2-3 minutes what it is. So we have already seen symmetric key cryptography, right? So what is used there? A same secret key is shared between the sender and receiver. So that is called as symmetric key cryptography. So it is fast and efficient because mainly it does not work on numbers. It works on permutations and combinations of symbols only, right? So that's why it is fast and efficient. However, it suffers from a big disadvantage of the problem of key exchange. Now, as I said yesterday, we have not discussed this, so we will discuss what is the problem today, because that is the best time to take it now. So then, in symmetric key cryptography, as I said, same key is used, okay? But the problem is it is very tough to agree upon a common key, okay? So then asymmetric key cryptography solves this problem. So here each communicating party uses two keys to form a key pair, which is called a private key, and the other corresponding key is the public key. So public key is shared with everybody. So when you talk about keys, there are again two separate keys, one private and one public. So if encryption and decryption are thought of as locking and unlocking padlocks with keys, as we saw in asymmetric key cryptography, what we saw, we had an image of a padlock at the left side and a padlock at the right side. So a key was locking the padlock here, and the same key was unlocking the padlock over here. So same key was used for locking and unlocking. So that is symmetric key cryptography, but that is not the case here. So the padlock is locked with a public key here, but it can only be unlocked with the corresponding private key. So means if I have a public key, I'll always have a corresponding private key. I can't use any private key. I'll only the corresponding private key, which is corresponding to this public key, will unlock the padlock. So the next figure will make this a bit more clear. So I have an ally sending a message to Bob. Okay. So since who is the receiver? Bob. So the onus lies on the receiver. So he has to provide both the keys. So public key is publicly available. So ally takes Bob's public key, since it is publicly available, locks the message with this key using the encryption algorithm and sends it through any insecure channel. So once this is received, this lock is received using a decryption algorithm and his own private key. So Bob only has access to his private key, right? So he unlocks it using this key. Remember, even if Bob cannot unlock this using his own public key also, he can unlock it only using his own private key. And no one else, even if he gets the lock, even if he or she gets the padlock, will not be able to open the padlock. Why? Because it can be only unlocked with Bob's private key, and it will be with Bob only. So that is the crux of asymmetric key cryptography or crypto system. So then we talked about public key distribution channel. We also said that even though it is public, it should be what? Giving authentication and integrity. So what is that? We'll again see in the next slide. So Alice wants to send a message to Bob. So Alice has a plain text, uses an encryption algorithm and a public key of Bob. So from that he gets a ciphertext and he sends it through any insecure channel. So ciphertext is received by Bob. So what he does, he uses a decryption algorithm and his own private key. So from that he gets the plain text. So this is what different keys are used. So asymmetric key cryptography. So this is the general idea of asymmetric key cryptography. So what we understand from this single diagram is many things. So first thing which we understand is the onus mainly lies on the shoulders of receiver, right? Then we see there is a public key distribution channel here, right? So use a pointer. I came to know that I can use pointers here. Yeah, so this will be more clear for you. So we saw that there are public key distribution channels, right? So what are these public key distribution channels? So they are publicly available keys. So, but they are not required to provide secrecy, but they must provide authentication and integrity. Why? Because if I have a third person, let's say Eve, he should not be able to advertise her public key pretending that it is Bob's public key, right? So this should not happen. That's why this channel should provide authentication and integrity. So now what is authentication and integrity? We have studied in the first one or two lectures of encryption part of the course. So you can refer those videos if you have not yet seen. So then asymmetric key cryptography means what? That Bob and Alice cannot use the same set of keys for two-way communication. So what we saw here, Alice is sending a message to Bob. So who is the receiver? Bob. So we have the Bob's public key and private key. So if Bob wants to send Alice a message, so Alice public key and private key will come into picture. So the same, this key pair will not be used for two-way communication. That is what this sentence is saying. So then asymmetry key cryptography also means that Bob needs only one private key to receive all correspondence from anyone in the community, right? But Alice needs n public keys to communicate with n entities in the community. So we understood this with the help of the example of a bank. So if there are three customers who want to send transaction details like debiting the amount or crediting the amount with some amount to the bank, so how, what will they require, what they will do, bank will send, have a public key. So each of the customer will take a public key, use an encryption algorithm, right? So from that they will get the ciphertext output. It is not shown here, but it is assumed, right? So then they send it to bank. So since it is encrypted with bank's public key, only bank's private key can unlock it. And who has the bank's private key? Obviously the bank has. So the bank can decrypt it, right? So how many keys are used here? Here you are seeing again only one key. But if again customer A is there, he wants to send message to bank. Let's say he wants to send message to person C also. So what will he require? He will require C's public key. So if he is sending messages to two people, he is requiring two keys. Public keys. If he wants to send message to one more person, he'll require one more key. So that is what this saying. So if he needs n public keys to communicate with n entities, that is what that sentence means. So then in symmetric key cryptography, as I said at the start of the lecture, symbols are permuted or substituted. So we saw there is substitution or transposition. So permutation is nothing but transposition. But what happens in asymmetric key cryptography is numbers are manipulated, right? Then one key is used for encryption and only the other corresponding key, as I am always stressing, must be used for decryption. So what is the importance? No other key can decrypt the message, not even the original, that is the public key which was used for encryption. So then what we see is, if two people want to communicate, they just need a key pair for communication, okay? So that is what this sentence is saying. So how this asymmetric key cryptography works on the basis of numbers, as it is said here, is if you have an extremely large number that has only two factors, which are prime numbers, remember, then you can generate a pair of keys. Let's take a very simple crude example of 10. 10 has only two factors. Remember, 10 may or may not be a prime number. In fact, it will not be a prime number because it can be factorized. So 5 and 2, but the thing is 5 and 2 should be prime. So if you apply 5 as an encryption factor, only 2 can be used as the decryption factor, nothing else. Not even 5 itself can do the decryption. So as we saw yesterday, it is quite simple. Okay, so in practice, a very large number will be used. And if you actually try to calculate it, even years of computation cannot break the scheme. Okay, so that is why this asymmetric key cryptography is used almost everywhere. So then we saw this difference. So then the most important algorithm is Rivest-Shamir-Adelman algorithm, abbreviated as RSA algorithm, right? So it was devised in 1978. So what was the basis of this? That it is easy to find and multiply large numbers together. So if you are told to write a code, let's say in MATLAB, Scilab, etc., to multiply two large prime numbers, you can write it. You can do successive addition, or you can use just A into B, right? So it will be a 2-3 lines code. Or maximum 5 lines code if you are using successive addition, maximum 10 lines code. But if you are asked to write the other way, that is, if you are given some number and factorize it such that two primes are always the factors, then it will be extremely difficult to write the code. And that is why, as written here, it takes years of computation to find the answer to that algorithm. Okay, so that is the crux of the, or the heart of this RSA algorithm. So then the public and private keys, as we discussed in RSA, are based on very large numbers in which of 100 digits or more. So you can imagine the complexity of the numbers. So then we saw, is it not going forward? Okay, so then we saw the steps. So first step is to choose two large prime numbers P and Q, then calculate n equal to P into Q. Then select a public key, that is the encryption key E. So this E is taken from this encryption key. It is also called as exponent. Why? Because it is used as raised to e here, right? So that's why it is also called as exponent, such that it is not a factor of p minus 1 and q minus 1. Now, can you think and tell me this is which function which you have studied in mathematics of cryptography? This is p minus 1 into q minus 1. What are p and q? Prime numbers, right? So it should not be a factor of p minus 1 and q minus 1. So this is what Euler's totient function or Euler's phi function, because what is phi of n? It is p minus 1 into q minus 1. So this part is nothing but phi of n. Then once you have selected e, select the private key such that this is satisfied. D into e mod phi of n, I can say equal to 1. So you have encryption key and decryption key, that is public key and private key. Then cipher, then as whatever is the plain text to take it, then you raise it to e mod n. So n is here. Then send it to receiver. Then plain text is cipher text raised to d mod n. So if you have a doubt that these are numbers, but what if you want to send symbols? So we have seen that A to Z are given as numbers from 0 to 25. So in that way you can encode that. Okay. So that again we'll see. So this was the example based on that. So we'll skip this. So then these were the attacks. So let's take one example which can be asked in the exam. So Bob chooses 7 and 11 as P and Q. If he chooses the exponent E as 13, find the other exponent. Means E is what? Encryption key. So we have to find decryption key. Also prove that ciphertext is equal to plain text, assuming plain text as phi. Actually, it should be mentioned that the algorithm in use is RSA. I missed that. So what is the first step? Calculate n equal to p into q. Right? So n is p into q. So 11 into 7 is 77. What is second step? Or third step now in this? So choose e such that it is not a factor of p minus 1 into q minus 1. So phi of n is, it is as I told you, so p minus 1 into q minus 1 is 60, right? So then what we have to do? Select the public key such that it is not a factor of p minus 1 into q minus 1. So e is already given, so this step is done. E is given as 13. So then we have to find the decryption key. So what it should satisfy? It should satisfy this equation. So d into e mod phi of n is 1, okay? So I have written the answer here, but how you have to calculate? So if you see, this is the definition of multiplicative inverse. So I'll just revise it for you. You have forgotten. So I have that PPT already open here. So where is it? Multiplicative inverse. Yeah. So in Zn, two numbers a and b are multiplicative inverse of each other if a into b is congruent to 1 mod n. So as I told you in this particular lecture that a, this can be written as a into b mod n is equal to 1. So that is the same thing here, right? So it is a into b mod n equal to 1. So n is phi of n here, right? And a and b is d into e, right? So how to find multiplicative inverse? That we saw here, the extended Euclidean algorithm can be used. So find the multiplicative inverse of b in Zn when n and b are given and GCD of n comma b equal to 1, right? So GCD of n comma b equal to 1, then only it exists, right? So this was the method, right? So take R1 and R2 as nb, equate them to nb, find n mod b, then you will get a number, then take this number here and so on. So we'll get R1 equal to 0, R1 and 0 finally. So if GCD of n comma b is R1, right? Then you have T1, T2. Initialize them to 0, 1, find T using the formula. Similarly, you'll get T1, T2. And if R1 equal to 1, as said here, GCD of n comma b should be 1, right? So when it will be 1? When it is 1, 0. So if R1 equal to 1, what is the inverse? T1, right? So that's what we are using here, right? So what is our modulus here? Phi of n. So phi of n is 60. So that I have taken here. Okay. Point. Okay. So this is the modulus. And what is the other number we have? Either we should have D or E. So we have E. So that is 13. So take it here. So 13, 4 is a 52. What is the remainder? 8. So what you do is first you calculate this part, then we can go here. So then take 13 year, 8 year. So 8 ones are 8, so 5 is the remainder. Then 8 year, 5 year, 5 ones are 5, 3 is the remainder. Then 5 year, 3 year, 3 ones are 3, 2 is the remainder. So if you do like this, you will finally get 10. So if you are not getting 10 year, for example, if you are getting 21 or 20, then the inverse does not exist. But in this case, since they have given ES 13, the inverse should exist. Otherwise, we could, don't want to get an answer, right? So since this is there, inverse exists. So then T1, T2, T. So 0, 1 you do. Then what will be T? It is T1 minus Q into T2. So 0 minus 4 into 1. So minus 4. Then take 1 year minus 4 year. Then 1 minus 1 into minus 4. So 1 plus 4, which is 5. Then take minus 4 year, 5. So on, you calculate and you will get minus 23, 60. But so since this is 1, as we saw in the PPT, R1 inverse is T1. So T, what is our inverse? Minus 40, minus 23. So we want a positive number, so we add the modulus, which is 60. So 60 minus 23 is what? 37, right? So if you want, you can calculate that 37 into 13 mod 60 is 1. So if you want, I'll show it. So what is it? 37 into 13 divided by 60, it should be 480. So it is 8, right? So 60 into what? I have to multiply 80, because this was 8.01, right? Sorry, 8. So what will get? 480. So I want 481. So remainder is what? 1, right? So let's come back here. So this is not going. Yeah. So what is the D? We found out 37, right? So next, what is ciphertext? Plain text raised to 13 mod 77. So what is plain text? We have assumed it is given as 5. So 5 raised to E. E is 13. So mod 77. So you can calculate this again. If you calculate it, you will get it as 26. You can use your calci. So then send CT to the receiver. For this, you will get the answer. So then PT is CT raised to D. D is 37 mod 77. So this, even if you use calci, will not be able to calculate. But you know that it should be equal to plain text, and obviously we'll get it. So you can directly write as 5, even if it comes in the exam. Okay. So this is the way you can expect a numerical for RAC. So let's proceed further. So then this is one more example I have added just for information. So Jennifer creates a pair of keys for herself. She chooses P as this and Q as this. Then she calculates N is P into Q to get this number 159197. Then what will be phi of N? P minus 1, Q minus 1 multiplication. So it is 158400. Then she then chooses E as 343 and D as 1200. Then, so Jennifer wants to send the message. So show how Ted can send a message to Jennifer. Sorry, it is the other way now. If he knows E and N. So E and N are known to Ted. So how we can send a message to Jennifer? So let's assume the message to be sent is no. But we know asymmetric key cryptography can send numbers only. So convert N O to numbers. So we know A and N, A to Z is 0 to 25. So if you calculate N, it will be 13, O will be 14. So what will be ciphertext? Plain text. So N O concatenated 1314 raised to E. What is E? 343 mod 159197, which was calculated here. So if you calculate that, you will get 3367. Similarly, you can calculate decipher it as in this way, so you will get the same number again. Okay, so this is one more example how to send the alphabets. Okay, that's why I have included this example. So then, as I said in the first or second slide, we'll discuss today problem of key exchange. So let's assume person A wants to send a highly confidential letter to another person B. Also assume that A and B both reside in the same city but are separated by a few miles and for some reason cannot meet each other. So what is the best possible thing you can send it securely from A to B? So what does A think is, I'll have an envelope, put the letter in the envelope, seal it and send by post. Okay. But what is the guarantee that the person who is carrying this envelope does not open it, right? So this method fails. So then A thinks that I'll send by registered post then. So this was not registered post, this was normal post. So if he sends by registered post, so the security improves. But still it is not guaranteed because the postman can opens it again. So then he thinks that I'll hand it to a third party. But again, what is the guarantee that the third party is again trustworthy? So it is not acceptable. Then what he thinks is, I'll put the envelope in a box, send it to B. In fact, he'll put the envelope in a box, lock that box and send it to B. Right? So box is received by B, so problem is solved because no one can tamper with, because he is not sending the key. Right? But what is the problem? What about the key? So what has happened here? A has sent the message to B, but it is not accessible to B because B does not have the key. So what has happened? Prevented unauthorized access, which was required, but it also prevented authorized access because B should be able to access that box, right? So it defeats the purpose itself, right? So then what is the option? Send key with the box. So again, it is not acceptable. So through whom we are sending, he has the key. So that is not acceptable, right? So what he thinks is, send boxes before and meet B at some decided place to give the key. But what is the assumption? They cannot meet each other. So the assumption itself is failing, right? So we are facing a lot of problems here. So this problem is called as the problem of key exchange, okay? So this is called as the problem of key exchange because they are not able to agree on a key. So since the sender and receiver will use the same key to lock and unlock, this is called symmetric key cryptography. So when used in the context of cryptography, it is called as symmetric key. Okay. So then thus we observe that the key distribution problem is inherently linked with what? Symmetric key operation only. If we want to say use the same key only. So that is the problem with symmetric key cryptography. So we go to asymmetric key cryptography. First thing. So this is a problem of key exchange. So you can get a 5 marks or question based on this, especially in the compulsory part. So you can write this example itself. And if you think further, this was communication between two people only. If the number of people who want to communicate are increased, this problem aggravates further. So when A wanted to communicate with B, we needed only one lock and key pair. Now let's say A wants to communicate with B as well as C. So what will happen? We'll require two lock and key pairs, A to B and A to C, right? So there will be separate keys, remember. Now let's say B also wants to communicate with C. So AB is there, AC is there, BC is also there. So we require three lock key pairs, right? So let's say there is a fourth person more. So A to B, A to C, A to D, then B to C, B to D and C to D, right? So this will have all the combinations. So what is happening here? We required one for two persons. For three persons, we required three. But for four persons, we are requiring 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So the number is increasing. It is not equal to the number of persons. It is more than equal to the number of persons. So if you see in general, if you calculate, it is nothing but the formula of permutation. So it is, if there are n persons to be communicating, the number of keys required are n times n minus 1 by 2. So if 1000 persons are communicating, if you calculate, it will be almost 5 lakh lock and key pairs are required, which is not at all acceptable, right? So that is the problem of key exchange. So to solve this problem, two people called as Diffie and Hellman gave a very good algorithm called as Diffie-Hellman key exchange or key agreement algorithm, and it was given in 1977. In fact, the RAC algorithm is just an extension of this algorithm. Okay. So what is the procedure that is given here? First, Alice and Bob agree on any two large prime numbers n and g. They can be any large prime numbers, but the important thing is they should be prime numbers. Why they should be large? Because the larger the prime numbers, the harder the computation for the attackers. So these two integers need not be kept secret. They can be kept open through any insecure channel. And Alice and Bob can obviously then use an insecure channel to agree on them. Then Alice chooses another large random number x and calculates a such that. So this is a random number. It can be a prime number or a composite number also. And he calculates a such that a is g raised to x mod n. Then Alice sends number a to Bob. Bob independently chooses another large random integer again and calculates b such that b is g raised to y mod n. Bob sends number b to Alice. Okay. Then, so Bob has number a and Alice has number b. So now a now computes the secret key k1 as follows. So k1 is b raised to x mod n. So Alice, as I said, has b. So he has b and he has chosen the random number x. So he raises that to x. And mod n, he has n also, because they are agreed upon by both of them together. So then V computes the secret key K2 as A raised to Y mod n. So and if you calculate this, let's see what happens. So this is the pictorial view. Okay. So let's say n is 11 and g is 7. Okay. Let's say x equal to 3 for the simpler purpose of calculation. So a is 7 raised to 3 mod 11. Okay. So 7 raised to 3 is 343. So 11 3s are 33, 11 1s 11. So remainder is 2. We can do it orally. Right. So Ali sends the number A to Bob is the third step. So Ali sends 2 to Bob. Then Bob independently, remember, chooses another large random integer y and calculates b such that b is g raised to y mod n. That y is 6. So what is b then? G. G was what? 7. So 7 raised to 6. So if you calculate this, it will come out the remainder as 4. Okay. So then 4 is sent to Ls. So Bob sends 4 to Ls. So A now composes the secret key k1 as b raised to x mod n. So what was b? B was 4. So 4 raised to x. Sorry. 4 raised to x. X is 3. So 4 raised to 3, which is 64, 4 is 16, 16, 4 is 64. Yeah. So 11, 5 is 55, remainder is 9. So k1 is 9. Similarly, if you calculate k2, it is a raised to y. So 2 raised to 6. So 64 mod 11. So 11, 5 is 55, again remainder is 9. So what you see, k1 and k2 are equal. Right? So this solved the problem of which was faced of the key agreement, right? So without anyone interfering and choosing these large prime numbers and sending through insecure channel and using any two large random numbers, that is the main beauty of this algorithm. You can take any large random number independently and then two will get k1 equal to k2 for symmetric key cryptography. Okay. So this is called as Diffie-Hellman key exchange algorithm. So usually you get a question like explain Diffie-Hellman key exchange algorithm with the help of an example. So you first write this, then you say this is the example. If you want, you can draw this diagram as well if time permits. Okay. So this is what we'll do today. So we'll stop here for today.